welcome to King Skeleton Channel. This is Bo. Shelby's behind the camera. Shelby, say hi.
Hey, guys.
How we doing? Yes, I am inside of an 18-wheeler truck. We have a guest in the house that he actually owns this truck and Leland's driving it.
Okay,
well, he's not the owner of the truck, but he drives this truck for his company. So we have a guest in the house. Everybody, I want you to meet Philip Miller.
Hey, guys.
Everybody give a round of applause for Phil.
Trust me, the ugly face will make you run. Don't do it.
Phil, how are we doing today?
We're peachy as a peach, man.
Okay, I really do appreciate taking the time to do this interview with me and everything.
You know, it was nice to be here that y'all wanted to do this, so it's actually convenient for both. It's been a while since I've been able to take some time just to do stuff like this.
Right.
Usually I'm always focused with work.
So, Phil, I got a few questions, if you don't mind, about pretty much your life on the road and everything. So, how long have you been trucking?
You know, I mean, it's a couple different answers. It all depends on how you look at it. I started out when I was 17. Had opportunity, so I ran with it. I didn't get my license until about 13, 14 years ago. So that's where I could go work for other companies. I was like, what the fuck? We're getting attacked. But it's the muffins. So technically with a CDL license, I've only been 13, 14 years, but I've been trucking since I was 17, actual physical drive across country. I like what I do out here. It's a good life. You got to make it fun. If not, it's just boring holding the steering wheel. So you always got to have fun, have your friends and family.
So did you had a job before you started trucking?
I did. I started out in detailing. My first job was Winn-Dixie. It's a grocery store down in South Florida.
Okay.
And I did that. I started that when I was 16, and then, you know, I started doing detailing. And then that's when I started detailing show trucks, and then I just slowly moved up. Once I got around trucks, that was it. I was going to get my foot through the door. So I didn't go to truck driving school or anything like that. Florida, there was loopholes, so that's what I used to get in.
When I was 5 years old, my father would always, you know, go next to these trucks on this main stretch highways and everything. I would go like this, you know, and have them honk the horn. And ever since I saw these trucks and everything else, I was fascinated with them. Because it was always hearing these sounds or hearing the gear shifting and everything and hearing the loud engine and everything else and hearing that Jake brake, that blah, 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 you know. And when I was a kid and everything, and as I was growing up, I was just so hardcore into these trucks. Now, was your life similar to that, in that direction, or was it because you wanted to follow in your father's footsteps and continue that life?
You know, the thing was I loved what my dad did. He wasn't around much, but we always had clothes on our back, a roof over our head, and the bills and everything were always paid.
Pretty much did what he's able to do.
Yep, and you know, and when I got into it, I wanted to do it different. I wanted to make a difference for my family, but I also wanted to make the difference in the world. So my mentality was if I push harder in trucking, I'll stand out in my own light, and I won't be compared to like everybody else. So for me, trucking is just not like a job, it's a hobby. It's something that I really like. And anyone that does hobbies, they're really into them. And that's how it is for me with trucking, and I see that's how it is with you. So that's basically like trucking in a nutshell for me.
And see, I have epilepsy and everything else, and this was supposed to be my dream. This, you know, driving a company truck like, you know, you're doing and everything, and, you know, being on the road, I love driving and everything, and I've always wanted to, you know, have the experience of, you know, being on the road like a trucker. I've always been fascinated with it.
Well, but there you go. It's your chance. Switching seats.
We're switching seats, guys. Hang on a second. Apparently now I'm driving. No, I'm kidding. I'm not driving. I would not know where to go.
Okay. So now.
Now we're comfortable.
Because I got a lot of miles with my ass in that seat. I don't have none with it over here. So
how does it feel being over there?
It's different. I don't like it.
That's what I feel like in my
car. You
can
have it back.
No.
No.
This is your time to shine, brother.
Okay.
You know, and that's the thing, man, is for me, it was, I always wanted to make the difference in trucking, and whether it was making someone happy or smiling or something, you know, people look, well, it's just a day, you know, it's a job, you know, I make a paycheck. It's so much different because, I mean, you imagine each truck has something that's going to go to a family's home. So you're making a difference with inside of a family, inside of the country for everyone to build on. And it's like, that's why I'm really into this.
Right.
You know, because, I mean, we all want to make a difference. What we do today determines how tomorrow's going to be for everybody. So that's how I look at it.
And like I said, like I was trying to explain to you before we switched seats and everything was, I have epilepsy to where I can't do something like this. And this was supposed to be my dream. This is what I wanted. And my father said, you know, I will pay for everything, your trip, your schooling and everything, if that's really what you want to do. And that's what I really wanted to do and everything, take care of my bills and my issues and everything else. And this was supposed to be my dream.
Now I
can't do it. The only thing I have is the truck simulator.
Yeah. Well, we have separate dads, because when I told my dad when I wanted a truck, he said he was going to break my fucking arms and legs.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he didn't want me to be a truck driver.
And why is that?
Because he wanted a better life for me. I had a scholarship.
Did he not like trucking or something?
No, he knew what trucking was. It was changing, and it wasn't changing for the better. He was right. But everything changes. So back then, and you know, the mid-90s, trucking was way different than what it is now in the 2020s. So it's like, you know, you got computers and all this, right. You know, more regulations and government. So, I mean, do I regret it? No, I don't regret it. I had a scholarship for the U.S. Coast Guard. I could have been retired already.
Oh, wow.
A full ride.
How did that go?
I dropped out of high school.
Oh.
And I took a different path in life. And I lost my ride.
Was there a reason for that?
You know,
if you don't mind me asking.
No, I mean, when you're 16, 17 years old, you know, as men, we think we know it all. And then once we get our ass in the huckle buckle, we're like, hey, Dad.
Right.
Hey, you're right, you know, no. Not for nothing.
I was just being stupid, but, you know.
Exactly. So that's what I did. So at the age of 18, I signed myself out of school, and I was like, you know what, I'm going to go trucking, and that's what I did. Do I make more money than some people that have gone to college and did the full thing? Of course, but there's people that make more money than me too. So,
of how long you've been trucking already? How many companies have you went in and out with? A little. Do you remember the company's names that you've been in and out with? Like you work in a company and then all of a sudden you're like, no, this ain't working for me. So you move on to another one.
So my first company I worked for was called Hill and Dale Farms, and it was an egg company, a chicken company. And it was a local gig, so I started out with them. Well, they got bought up by Kelmaine Foods, which is one of the biggest food distribution centers in the Midwest, based out of Oklahoma. And then from them, I went to Windy Hill. They're based out of Marshfield, Wisconsin, right down the street from Lyle. And that's where I started OTR with the CDL.
So what made you quit that company?
Because that is a family shellac. That I was making 18 cents a mile, and it was a dead end. It just, no matter how hard you work, you know, how less you work, it didn't matter. It was just, you could never catch ahead. The harder you worked, you were making the same amount of money. It didn't matter. And I don't like that mentality. If I do more, I want to see more.
Right.
I don't want to be Bill Gates, but I want to see more, you know? But, so after them, I went to Sun State Carrier.
How'd that go?
That was good. That's when my career actually started peaking. That's when I was really running outlaw.
Explain that a little bit.
So, basically, orange juice was really big in Florida, still is. So, most of your orange juice, I don't care if it's Florida Natural or Coca-Cola orange juice, it comes in a 55-gallon drum from Brazil, Mexico, or California. It's not Florida grown.
Huh. Interesting.
And they take it to the, we'll take it to like Coca-Cola or Florida Natural or Minute Maid, whoever, and they'll process it up to be orange juice or whatever it is they're looking to do with it.
Interesting. Have you ever done cattle driving?
Never.
You haven't pulled any livestock or anything?
No, that's a different beast, brother. I'm a door swinger. You know, and a door swinger is reefer, box trailers. I've done some oversized loads, but oversized, that's a different beast.
So, speaking of oversized loads in there, what's the heaviest, let alone the biggest? If you remember what you were carrying, what was the biggest load that you've carried?
The biggest load I carried was a box coming out of Newark, New Jersey, coming out of the port side. I was 14 wide and 14 tall. The box only weighed, with the product inside, was maybe 22,000, 25,000 pounds. But the box was to protect the machine inside. What the machine inside was, I really couldn't tell you because the bills weren't really laid out to describe what was in it.
So what was the experience like driving that? Was it pretty difficult, pain in the ass?
It's different, you know, because, I mean, when you're in New Jersey trying to get out of the city, nobody's working with you.
Right.
Nobody cares. You're taking up a lane and a half on each side, and nobody cares. So that if there's a bicycle lane, oh, you're gonna blow them off the road, or you're gonna hit them with the box. I've blown them off the road, and that's kind of hilarious. You can't help laugh. But I was over in Texas. I jumped over as far as I could. When I went past them, they went head over because all the wind off the box. And
right. So speaking of wind or whatever, when you're driving, when it's a very windy day, it's nice out, you know, it's clear sky, but it's really windy. How does this rig react to that, going about 55, 60 miles an hour?
Scary.
Scary?
Scary. Like when I was coming across Wyoming, it was very windy over there. They had 40 mile an hour winds. So you got to take in consideration, 40 miles an hour with 80,000 pounds, that's all it takes to roll this vehicle over. A 40 mile an hour wind gust. So if it gusts over 40, you're doing 50, so that's basically 90 miles an hour worth of wind. Wouldn't take much to blow you over.
Yeah, all right. I heard that even though trucks were heavy in there, but, you know, a good gust of wind can knock a whole rig over, you know, and it probably does not help either when the lighter the load, the worse it gets, is what I've heard.
Light loads are great, but they're out, so there's a lot of disadvantage. You got to be more cautious. So if it starts raining, my wheels aren't fully on the ground. If it's snowing, I got less traction. So my chances of spinning out are a lot better than someone that's 75,000 gross. He's more planted on the ground. His disadvantage is braking time. It's going to take him a lot further to slow down. Well, for me, it's going to take twice as long for me to slow down. Because I just don't have nothing to really
grab,
make the brakes grab.
So when it comes to wintertime dealing with snow, I've noticed that there was chains on the side of your rig. They told me it was for the tires on the rig to try to have some kind of traction. Now, how does that work and how well does it work? Does it work well enough to where it's like you kind of feel comfortable, or is it still like, oh shit?
It's like a dinosaur, it's old age. You know, it really is. But it does a lot of damage to the roads. So basically, just imagine you got two lines, and then you got straps going across every so many inches. So those straps, what they do is they're actually loose. So when the wheel's spinning, it actually comes up off the tire, and it smacks the ground, so it breaks the ice. And what it causes. It breaks the ice, so it causes for you to grab traction. So for the trailer, since there's nothing really driving the axles, you basically just want that vehicle to stay right behind you. Because if that trailer comes out, well, it doesn't matter what you're doing up here. You're going to go for a ride, most likely.
Right.
If you speed up, you can pull out of it, but sometimes you just go for a ride.
Now, how scary is it? Because, like I said, for myself, I've never really actually, you know, the trip that you gave me earlier, you know, just a few miles, of, you know, down the highway and everything else, but I've really never actually been in a rig state to state or be gone for a few days. But around I believe West Virginia, around that area, I'm sure you've been there before, when you were up in the mountains, have you ever had an issue in the winter time up in the mountains? How scary is that if you had that experience?
Well, see, I don't really run West Coast or East Coast anymore, and they really, I mean, there's some good hills over there, but on the West Coast the elevations are a lot more.
Have you ever been to the Carolinas?
Yeah, I've ran through the gorge out there. To me, that's really nothing. Now, when you start going out west, you got Donner's Pass in California. It's 50 miles down. That's one mountain, 50 miles down. And it's not straight down like, you know, a sled. It goes down in increments. But the problem is if you heat up too quickly, before you get to the bottom, you'll burn up. And see, Donner's Pass, if you look up the history, even back in the 70s and 80s, they used to burn the brakes out.
Right. So I've noticed, and I've actually heard this from other truckers and everything else, and since now I am actually face-to-face with an actual trucker.
I'm just doing all my brother. Who told you I'm a truck driver? They're full of shit.
Wait, that's me.
Yeah. Fuck, I'm out here.
You
know,
right?
I quit.
hand over the keys.
Yeah, I heard an ignition.
Oh, right, okay. Here we go. I heard that when you're going up a hill or down a hill, you're supposed to turn your hazards on to let the other cars, let alone trucks or anything that's behind you or around you, to give you alert. They give them a hazard alert of, hey, I'm driving, you know, I'm a rig, you know, be careful how you're driving around me and everything, let alone behind me.
Well, I mean, if you're coming like out of Denver going through the Eisenhower Tunnel, it's a pretty steep grade going up. So if you're 30,000-40,000 in the box, you're going to be down around 40,000-45,000. So, you know, the safety thing is to throw the hazards on just to let everyone know that, hey, I'm a very slow moving vehicle. Even with the hazards on to people, you really don't see it or notice. Yeah. Yeah. It's just everyone's too busy texting and driving, you know. And it's,
you drive a lot better when you put the phone down.
You know what, man? I get more miles done when I have the phone in my hand, but...
We won't discuss that.
That's for next week's show.
Right. So how hard is it? Because I remember you told me before that, you know, you've been married at least, what, twice? And everything else. So with that life of you being trucking there with wife and kids and, you know, trying to have a family and try to be the man you want to be with a father and a husband, how hard is it, and what advice would you give to these folks on, if you're going to truck and you have a family, you know, explain how that felt to where you were on the road constantly and you could not hug your wife or see your kids, you know, within weeks at a time?
Well, I mean, for me, sometimes it was more than weeks at a time. Because, I mean, you really couldn't afford to come home. See, whenever you start in trucking, you can't come home every week. You can't come home every couple of weeks. You're just not making enough money. After your first year of trucking, that's when you're going to start coming into a little bit more money. Things are going to level up, and you'll be able to come home more often. Just stay away from the lease purchases, because they are just a joke. You just stay away from them. That's the best advice. But the thing was, for me, is I talked it over with my wife. And my daughter was like a couple years old, you know, 2 years old, and then I wanted to run. So we agreed on it. I thought she had my back. For the most part, she did. She supported everything I did. But you know what, man? Trucking changes as a person. You have to have two personalities. Right. Your personality as a truck driver, because if any one of these guys out here think that you're soft and they can get one in, they will. It's almost like prison out here. It's every man for himself.
Right.
So, I mean, with that being said, so then when you get home, you got to flip that switch off and be father, family man, husband, wife, blah, blah, blah. And sometimes it's hard. Sometimes her bad days and your bad days clash together out here on the road, and it makes it for a very difficult situation.
I mean, it sounds, you know, with you explaining all that and everything else, to me, it sounds like, it's like two different personalities, you know, two different personalities, because you have to have a job to be a husband and a father, then you have to have a job to be on the road. And that sounds really much of a pain in the butt, let alone very stressful for you and everything too, especially when you're already gone days or weeks at a time already, and you get a phone call from, you know, your daughter or your wife and everything saying, I miss you and everything. And I'm sure there's been times you try not to tear up because you miss them so much.
Of course, you know, the longest I've ever did on one from start to finish on a trip was about 5 months at one time.
Wow.
5 months. And that was because I wanted to give my family a good vacation, and I had to get the bills ahead. So I had this. That was the sacrifice. I mean, and that's the thing. With trucking, you have to sacrifice a lot to get a little.
Right.
You know, and that's what it is. It's little at a time. So, like, now... I mean, I could go home after this trip and be good for a week or two and then go back out. But, I mean, we all like money, so that's why I'm going to go back out, and I got other stuff going on. So the money, it helps, you know. But my boss has priorities for this truck, too. It has to pay its own bills. There's truck payments, insurance, and all this. So I got to make sure he's making money. If he's making it, I'm making it.
Right.
You know,
right.
That's how it is.
That's how it is,
yeah.
And it's just like, you know, Walmart and grocery stores. It's like when the store is getting paid, then the employees and everything are getting paid. So it's...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the money kind of cycles through, you know.
Exactly. So, and the first cut out is the fuel, because you burn that up before the actual payment of the bills, you know. But, you know, I mean, and that's the thing. It's like, trucking's not bad. It's whatever you make of it. But, I mean, if you want the truth or the lie, I can give you the truth, and that's what I give.
Right. A couple more questions, and then we'll, you know, let you head on your way. Other than that, when it comes to a full tank of gas in this truck, how many miles can you go? How many trips can you make without being like, oh crap, I need to fill up?
Okay, so, I mean, it all depends on how much weight you got. So, like, where my fuel gauge is at right now, we roughly got about 130 gallons left in these tanks. So, on each side, there's 150 gallons on the driver's side and 150 on the passenger side, for a total of 300 gallons of what I can hold on this truck. So to fill up from empty, you're probably looking more closer to $500 with today's fuel prices at $2.35 a gallon.
I hope that doesn't come out of your pocket.
No, no, God. I mean,
you would have no paycheck.
I mean, my fuel bill on this truck, I watch it very closely for my boss, because I don't want it to get out of hand. But so, I mean, so a trip from New Ulm, Minnesota to south to San Diego, up to Sacramento, roughly with this truck, I think it was like $1,100 of what it costs us on fuel. It adds truck for the fuel, the DAF, the reefer fuel, and everything like that, which is not bad. That's doable, you know.
Right.
But what we got to go out there for, what they paid us to go out, was a lot more. So it really didn't affect much at all.
So for backing up into a trailer, or making, you know, it's just kind of like two or three questions together combined. What about when you're making wide turns and everything, when there's cars on the one side of the lane and you're trying to make the turn, let alone backing up a trailer or backing up to hook up a trailer? What kind of complications is that?
Man, it all depends on your day. Something could be so difficult, it could be a nightmare. And I've had days like that, because, like, you know, you drop one trailer and you're, oh, there's my trailer, and then the fifth wheel jams. Now you got to go into the shop. So, you know, sometimes things get worse than what they really need to be. It's right. Just the way life goes. But, I mean, on a normal, you can hook up and be hooked up, ready to go in less than 10 minutes and down the road. Dropping a trailer, about the same, you know, 5-10 minutes on. It just matters how quick you want to be about it. Backing up, and that's always just take your time.
That's what I was like, because when you backed this truck up when I was sitting where you were sitting, and after you gave me a ride and everything, when I saw you lay on when I was recording you and everything, you were backing this truck up like it was nothing. And it was like, I wish I could do that in my trucking game to make it look easy, you know? So it's just like, and all you have is these side mirrors.
That's it. I don't have mirrors on the hood or nothing like that. But it took a lot of practice. Before I went out on the road, I practiced on a FLD 120. Hooked a 48-foot trailer. A 48-foot trailer is harder to back up than a 53. Because the 48
turns. So you tested quicker. Yourself to do something harder than...
I practice.
Okay.
A lot of practice. And the reason being is because when you come out, everyone's coming off the road to either go to sleep, grab something to eat. You know, they don't want to sit there for 20 minutes while you're trying to back up and
right.
have a difficult time. So, you know, I practice. So, funny thing is, so if there's a trailer there and there's a trailer here, I can hit the hole all day long. You want me to hit the hole out there where there ain't nothing, then we're going to be there.
Right.
I can't hit it. I just can't hit it. I don't know why. I have to put an obstacle somewhere so I can get it around. So, if we're up there in that wide part of the parking lot, I'd be here all day trying to hit it. I couldn't hit it if it hit me, man. It's just, I don't know what it is. I've always had that problem. So anytime I back up, I always try to make sure there's a trailer on that side, and then I can make it look easy. But if you want to see something funny, we'll go up there and do it, man. I mean, we'll all look like a bunch of this guy here, you know?
But the hell is this idiot doing?
Exactly, you know, it's just, but I mean, when I trained myself, I always trained it that there was a trailer here and a trailer there. Because, I mean, in most options, when you have stuff like that, you're not going to try to back into it. You just pull into it and be done for the night. So that's what I basically did. It was just train myself with trailers.
Cool. Do you have any questions?
No.
Okay. Well, I really do appreciate taking this time and everything to hang out with us and, you know.
It's been a pleasure, brother. You know, and we're going to do this again.
All right. Make sure you bring that Peterbilt 389.
I would definitely. If I can get it away from my boss, I would have brought it this time, you know. But I wanted my trailer. I got a 48-foot spread axle.
But I do have one more question before we leave here and for you to, you know, travel along and everything. Can you tell the folks what model this truck is, how much horsepower, what you're running on your transmission, and pretty much what you're hauling?
Well, the motor's ISX Cummins. It's a 2010 model, has 485 horsepower.
I have the same engine on my game.
Well, the 2010s are different than the X15s. The X15s are more fuel efficient. This one's not so fuel efficient, just because of the later time. But the cab of the truck is a 2013 Peterbilt 386, powered, driven by a 13-speed Eaton Fueler transmission. Basically, you know, I love my truck, but you know, all the groove. But the gear ratio in the backside is 342. So, I mean, at you know, around 75 miles an hour, you're pushing about 1,600-1,700 on the tank.
So, one more question. So, how many miles to the gallon does this rig haul? Do we want to know?
You want to know what the fuel economy is, yeah?
Well, you know, how many miles to the gallon does this thing get? Two?
No. Averaging 6.7 miles to the gallon.
You see that, folks? You see that?
So, yeah, the fuel economy in these aren't really good. You're less than 10 miles to the gallon.
So, if you're thinking about buying one, guys, and everything, and parking in your park in your driveway or whatever, do not get one because it's worse than a Hummer, okay? It's worse than an SUV. Just saying, okay?
Actually, these two will actually get better fuel economy than this.
What?
It's about 12 miles to the gallon.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I'm doing 6.5 miles per gallon.
So I'm guessing the heavier load, the gas mileage goes down because it gets harder, right?
Well, it all depends on when you really got to be there. Yeah, so, I mean, the heavier you are, the logic is it's going to take more energy to move that kind of weight. So the lighter you are, the less energy you need. So I'm only 13,000 pounds in a box. I got 12 pallets of carbon fiber. So, and they make airplane wings and stuff for the government out of it.
Have you hauled any of that before?
Not until I started working for this guy.
Okay.
Because the stuff that we haul is basically for NASA, Boeing aircraft, aerospace. I've seen some pretty cool stuff doing this job now, and I'm like a kid at a candy store. Right. Everyone's like, dude, you don't look like Urkel. Well, let me just whip out my pocket calculator.
Right.
You know, a Revenge of the Nerds, here we come. No. I like science, dude. I've always been fascinated because it's not that what they can do; it's how it works.
Right.
It's just it's
it blows your mind. It's,
yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that little thing can make something this big. You know?
Yeah. Well, see, like I got carbon fiber sheets on, so they'll make the whole plane out of carbon fiber. So, and the reason why they do it is because it's lighter and it's cheaper. So that if they destroy the plane. Because most of the time they're doing test runs with it, or they'll use the Air Force to shoot it out of the sky.
That makes sense on why planes are able to shred like paper. That explains it.
Well, let's look at Boeing aircraft for a moment, because I do a lot of stuff for Boeing, too. So, they built all these planes, and they just don't stay up in the sky. They had two of them come down. They grounded it. They quit making production of the plane. So, now they got about 500 of them sitting on a tarmac, and they can't do a thing. So, now they're stripping them. You know, and they found out that there was something wrong with the fuel tanks, the fuel lines, electric. They used the wrong bolts on an aircraft. Now, who, you know, and Boeing's pretty thorough because we hold the ledgers that they write whoever put what bolt in. So when the whole plane's built, there's so many signatures showing who built that plane, who used what wrench, everything, all the way down to the bottom.
Right.
And it's just amazing.
Yeah, it's very, very amazing. It's just like what I was telling, you know, Shelby and everything, that when today we were going to, you know, come all the way over here to meet you and everything else. You can even ask Shelby. I was like a little kid at a candy store. I was like, she tells me, like, slow down on your speed, you know, don't be a crazy driver, you know, because when I see trucks, let alone being around trucks, you know, different mile, you know, models and everything else, they're still trucks, and hearing them shifting those gears and those loud engines and those straight pipes, it really, like, I hate to say this, but it's like a turn on. I mean, it really is.
Well, see, like the thing that I miss with the old transmissions, when you would go back and forth, they used to make this sound,
right?
The clicking, and they don't no more. So I'm a little disappointed. That's what really got me. You know, that was my favorite thing.
Right.
But I mean, like when you're shifting, hearing that pop off of the air, that's what I really like, man. You know. But my drop visor, it just slow profiles a little bit more. So, I mean, like, when you're looking out, it cuts the lights out from all the lampposts.
So, you like, you know, your visor?
I do, but the only thing is if you pull too close to the light, you can't see the damn light when it goes green. And you're 63 foot long, so the asshole behind you that's blowing the horn, you don't hear him. You just wait for the finger, you know. Oh, it's green.
It's green. Green.
You know, down the road.
Red.
Yeah, exactly. No, usually I'm coming out. I got a Louisville back there. So it's you gotta, you know, stand back a little bit so you can see the lights. But I mean, other than that, when the sun is setting, that is the best thing in the world.
Right. And I'm sure when you're traveling, I'm sure, like, depending on where you're at, like if you're out, like, in the middle of, like, farm fields and everything, when that sun hits just right, I'm sure it's gorgeous to look at and everything else.
You know, I'll tell you what the best time is when it's snowing. If it snowed that night and the sun's up in the morning and it's not snowing no more, that is the best thing because you can see the crystals on top of the
right,
snow.
Right, yeah.
And that's, if you're in an elevation of 4,000 to 5,000 feet, the snow looks much softer and fluffier. I don't know what it is, but, you know, I'm like, all I think about is the Snuggles Bear coming out, you know, sleepy time.
So Christmas is your favorite holiday, though.
I love Christmas, dude. I love snow season. The only time I hate it is around February, because I've about had enough of the shit at that point, you know? And everyone's like, oh, doesn't it snow up here in Minnesota? Well, you know what? Not no more. It's all fucking ice. Then the snow hits. So the snow covers the ice, and it's a surprise. It's worse than Christmas because it's a gift you don't want.
I'm surprised on, you know, Christmas, on holidays and everything else, I'm surprised you actually don't put Christmas lights either inside or outside the truck.
You got to be careful with that. For the simple fact is, you know, depending on the region you run, there's a lot of ice endings on these bars, so I don't want to be fixing the lights,
right.
You know, or they come off and they start whipping cars or something, you know. That's why I
don't. Have you seen any truckers do that?
I've seen truckers do the reef on the front end or the lights on the inside around the windshield, but I don't got much windshield as is, so if I put lights around there at night, the glare off the windshield will be ridiculous, so that's why I don't mess with it.
And I'm sure it drives you nuts when there's drivers out there with regular vehicles, you know, like ours, for example, you know, trying to, like, you know, they'll pass you, but then they'll cut really short, and it's like, well, wait a minute, you almost got hit. And I'm sure that drives you nuts and gets you really frustrated, but at the same time, you're probably so used to it to where it's like, go figure.
Well, 9 times out of 10, depending on how the car's coming up next to you, you can basically see it happening. So if he's coming up real fast, yeah, most likely he's coming over no turn signal or nothing because there's his exit. It happens all the time. But as low as I sit in that seat, 9 times out of 10, I can't even see him going in front of me. So it's like, if I clip him, I'm just doing a Days of Thunder. Rubbin's racing, bitch. Get out of the way, you know?
So this is the final question that I want to ask. And I've actually been wanting to meet a truck driver and actually ask this question. Because... Wait, I gotta ask myself.
Yeah, exactly. Dude, I'm just here, you know, I'm the audio crew. I don't know nothing, man.
Welcome to my truck. You like it?
Nice, yeah, dude. The light don't work over here. Who knew, you know? Someone that paid electric bill get it.
You know, I just smoked out my transmission, you know, I couldn't learn how to gear it.
Dude, actually, I heard they put a new one in here, you know, the motor's been rebuilt. We're good to go.
Right.
Just don't fuel up in Arizona. That's all I ask. Jeez, the fuel prices are ridiculous.
So, this last question is important to me because I'm just curious on how you truckers, I've seen actual trucks when I'm driving on the road, I actually see, and I'm like, how hard is that? What I'm going to ask is, how hard is it of changing lanes when you have so many blind spots? You are percentage with more blind spots than a normal car. So how difficult is it and how nerve-wracking it is? Because you don't even know if there's a car right sitting right here on your blind spot, and you're switching, and you're afraid you're going to hit somebody. Like, explain how your feelings with that. Like, well, what was your routine on how to make sure when you change lanes, you're not going to hit anything?
Well, see, I use the four blink rule. I'll let the blinker blink 4 times. But if there's a car halfway, I'll wait for them to go and then I'll come over. But if there's a car far enough back where I can get over safely without slowing them down, I'll do it. But with that mirror there, I can basically see down the whole side of the truck. So if they're there by the door, I'm pretty good because I can, you know, I can see them. The hardest side is this side.
Right.
So I either, I call it the dog window down here.
Oh, I didn't know you had that.
Yeah, so I can see that there's a car.
See it?
Yeah, so I call it the dog window.
Rolla would love that window.
He would love it, trust me. That's where we go and lick our windows. That's why they call us window lickers. But you, you can't see from about where the front of the trailer is,
right,
about the sleeper. I can see that far back. So then I depend on that window to see if there's somebody right here. Because I can't see them with that mirror and I don't have a hood mirror.
So that helps you look at the car level.
Yeah,
what they're passing you, or if you're passing them.
Well, yeah, so like most cars have some kind of form of chrome on the front, so it'll reflect off the fender or something like that.
Oh, okay.
Let me know that.
All right. Perfect.
So, I mean, you got like before the days of trucking, before deregulation and all that, truckers never had CVs.
Yeah.
They had sign language. And most truck drivers, if there was a cop on the shoulder or something, they would use sign language to let the other traffic know. So before interstate systems, it was two lanes and 55 miles an hour. And that was trucking back then. Now, I mean, we got interstate systems and all sorts of expressways and tollways. So, I mean, you know, trucking's really took a big change. But the CB thing actually helps because I don't know how to sign language except for one word, you know, and that's, you know. Get the fuck out of the way.
Right.
You know.
When it comes to trucking, like trucks are the only thing that's not really the only thing that attracts me. Where it's the trucking, the CB radios, you know, talking to other drivers. And the one thing that amazes me, I only saw it one time in my life, and I was 10 years old, and it was back in the early 90s, where you had a thing that was called a convoy, where you had truck after truck after truck after truck. I only saw it one time, and it was in California.
Well,
and when I saw that, right after we passed the last truck for the convoy, the leader, all of a sudden we just saw Smokies pulling them over.
Well, see, you know, the thing is, the original convoy where they went from coast to coast, that was the best one of all. I mean, that was in the mid-70s, and, you know, and the thing was back then truckers stood, you know, they actually stood side by side with each other. Today, forget about it. I mean, it's a monopoly out here.
Right.
I mean, because no one cares about the other person. You know, as long as I'm making mine, I really don't care what y'all are barking about. But sometimes it's good to make a stand. Like, if truckers today took a stand today, in 2 days we could cripple this country. Right. Just that quick. And the only thing we got to do is stop the fuel trucks.
Right.
If we stop the fuel trucks, we stop the cars, we stop the electric, we stop the everything. Because everything's ran by some kind of fuel.
I know I said that was the last question, but I do have one more. If your truck breaks down or your tire pops, where you actually need to call your service, how much of a pain in the butt is that? Have you ever been in that situation where you had no choice to sit and wait for a service truck to come and help you out fixing with the engine or your transmission or a tire or something?
It is a nightmare. It is a nightmare.
Especially in the dark.
Well, it depends on where you break down. If you break out there in the Mojave Desert, just call a tow truck because there's no one out there.
Right.
So you're really going to pay out through the nose. But, I mean, popping a tire, I've sat on the side of the road for 5 hours waiting for someone just to change it. And the reason why was because it blew so bad if I drove, the rim or the tire would have come off the rim. So it would have caused more of a damage. So I was like, you know, I'm going to make them bring someone out. And that's what they did. But the thing is, I mean, it's so expensive. I mean, for one tire, you could buy, if you drove your truck to the shop, you spend about $300-$400. On the side of the road, it's about $700 now, just for one tire.
So when there's damage done to the vehicle, does that come out of your pocket or the company's pocket?
Well, it all depends if it was your fault. If you didn't check your air pressure.
If the tire popped, where did that come out of your pocket or the company?
It all depends, though. I mean, if you didn't pre-trip your truck and check it and make sure the tire was properly inflated, underinflation gets hotter than a tire that's properly inflated. So, I mean, with that being said, you know, it's one of those things. It could fall on the driver, and it could also just be a company
So how can you tell if it was your fault or if it was, you know, something sharp on the road and it just popped the tire?
Well, I mean,
how can you tell whose fault it was? The glass or you?
It all depends on how it blows. I mean,
but how can you do that if the tire is shredded?
Well, most tires really don't shred. If you think about it, you see the big old caps laying out in the middle of the road. So recaps, they're like a bomb. They'll just, when they go, it's ugly. But it always leaves a big chunk of rubber. So if you go back to that rubber and you look at it a little, you can basically tell the story of what really happened. A tire really doesn't blow unless it has one of the accoutrements that make it blow, a low tire. So the lower fuel economy than this.
What?
It's about 12 miles to the gallon.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I'm doing 6.5 miles per gallon.
So I'm guessing the heavier load, the gas mileage goes down because it gets harder, right?
Well, it all depends on when you really got to be there. Yeah, so, I mean, the heavier you are, the logic is it's going to take more energy to move that kind of weight. So the lighter you are, the less energy you need. So I'm only 13,000 pounds in a box. I got 12 pallets of carbon fiber. So, and they make airplane wings and stuff for the government out of it.
Have you hauled any of that before?
Not until I started working for this guy.
Okay.
Because the stuff that we haul is basically for NASA, Boeing aircraft, aerospace. I've seen some pretty cool stuff doing this job now, and I'm like a kid at a candy store. Right. Everyone's like, dude, you don't look like Urkel. Well, let me just whoop out my pocket calculator.
Right.
You know, a revenge of the nerds, here we come. No, I like science, dude. I've always been fascinated because it's not that what they can do, it's how it works.
Right.
It's
mind-blowing. It blows your mind. It's,
yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that little thing can make something this big. You know?
Yeah, we'll see. I got carbon fiber sheets on. So they'll make the whole plane out of carbon fiber. So, and the reason why they do it is because it's lighter and it's cheaper. So that if they destroy the plane, because most of the time they're doing test runs with it, or they'll use the Air Force to shoot it out of the sky.
That makes sense on why planes are able to shred like paper. That explains it.
Well, let's look at Boeing aircraft for a moment, because I do a lot of stuff for Boeing too. So they built all these planes and they just don't stay up in the sky. They had two of them come down, they grounded it, they quit making production of the plane. So now they got about 500 of them sitting on the tarmac and they can't do a thing. So now they're stripping them. You know, and they found out that there was something wrong with the fuel tanks, the fuel lines, electric. They used the wrong bolts on an aircraft. Now, and Boeing's pretty thorough because we hold the ledgers that they write whoever put what bolt in. So when the whole plane's built, there's so many signatures showing who built that plane, who used what wrench, everything, all the way down to the bottom.
Right.
And it's just amazing.
Yeah, it's very, very amazing. It's just like what I was telling, you know, Shelby and everything, that when today we were going to, you know, come all the way over here to meet you and everything else, you can even ask Shelby. I was like a little kid at a candy store. I was like, she tells me, like, slow down on your speed, you know, don't be a crazy driver, you know, because when I see trucks, let alone being around trucks, you know, different mile, you know, models and everything else, they're still trucks, and hearing them shifting those gears and those loud engines and those straight pipes, it really, like, I hate to say this, but it's like a turn on. I mean, it really is.
Well, see, like, the thing that I miss with the old, like, the old transmissions, when you would go back and forth, they used to make this sound.
Right.
The click in, and they don't no more. So I'm a little disappointed. That's what really got me. You know, that was my favorite thing.
Right.
But, I mean, like, when you're shifting, hearing that pop off of the air, that's what I really like, man, you know. But my drop visor, it just slow profiles a little bit more. So, I mean, like, when you're looking out, it cuts the lights out from all the
right.
lampposts.
So you like, you know, your visor.
But the only thing is if you pull too close to the light, you can't see the damn light when it goes green. And you're 63 foot long, so the asshole behind you that's blowing the horn, you don't hear him. You just wait for the finger, you know. Oh, it's green.
It's green. Green.
Shit, you're, you know, down the road.
Red.
Yeah, exactly. No, usually I'm coming out. I got a Louisville back there. So it's, you got to, you know, stand back a little bit so you can see the lights. But, I mean, other than that, when the sun is setting, that is the best thing in the world.
Right. And I'm sure when you're traveling, I'm sure, like, depending on where you're at, like, if you're out, like, in the middle of, like, farm fields and everything, when that sun hits just right, I'm sure it's gorgeous to look at. and everything else.
You know, I'll tell you what the best time is when it's snowing. If it snowed that night and the sun's up in the morning and it's not snowing anymore, that is the best thing because you can see the crystals on top of the
right,
snow.
Right, yeah.
And, that's, and when, if you're in an elevation of 4,000 to 5,000 feet, the snow looks much softer and fluffier. I don't know what it is, but, you know, I'm like, all I think about is the Snuggles Bear coming out, you know. Sleepy time. Or
so Christmas is your favorite holiday, though.
I love Christmas, dude. Dude, I love snow season. The only time I hate it is around February, because I've about had enough of the shit at that point, you know. And everyone's like, oh, doesn't it snow up here in Minnesota? Well, you know what? Not no more. It's all fucking ice. Then the snow hits. So the snow covers the ice, and it's a surprise. It's worse than Christmas because it's a gift you don't want.
I'm surprised on, you know, Christmas, on holidays and everything else, I'm surprised you actually don't put Christmas lights either inside or outside the truck.
You gotta be careful with that. For the simple fact is, you know, depending on the region you run, there's a lot of ice endings on these bars, so I don't want to be fixing the lights,
right.
You know, or they come off and they start whipping cars or something, you know. That's why I
don't. Have you seen any truckers do that?
I've seen truckers do the reef on the front end or the lights on the inside around the windshield, but I don't got much windshield as is, so if I put lights around there at night, the glare off the windshield will be ridiculous, so that's why I don't mess with it.
And I'm sure it drives you nuts when there's drivers out there with regular vehicles, you know, like ours, for example, you know, trying to, like, you know, they'll pass you, but then they'll cut really short, and it's like, oh, wait a minute, you almost got hit. And I'm sure that drives you nuts and gets you really frustrated, but at the same time, you're probably so used to it to where it's like, go figure.
Well, 9 times out of 10, depending on how the car's coming up next to you, you can basically see it happening. So if he's coming up real fast, yeah, most likely he's coming over no turn signal or nothing because there's his exit. It happens all the time. But as low as I sit in that seat, 9 times out of 10, I can't even see him go in front of me. So it's like, if I clip him, I'm just doing a Days of Thunder. Rubbin's racing, bitch. Get out of the way, you know?
So this is the final question that I want to ask. And I've actually been wanting to meet a truck driver and actually ask this question. Because... Wait, I gotta ask myself. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Dude, I'm just here, you know, I'm the audio crew. I don't know nothing, man.
Welcome to my truck. You
dude,
like
this
it?
This is nice, yeah, dude. The light don't work over here. Who knew, you know? Someone that paid electric bill, get
you know, I just smoked out my transmission, you know, I couldn't learn how to gear it.
Dude, actually, I heard they put a new one in here, you know, the motor's been rebuilt. We're good to go.
Right.
Just don't fuel up in Arizona. That's all I ask. Jesus, the fuel prices are ridiculous.
So, this last question is important to me because I'm just curious on how you truckers... I've seen actual trucks when I'm driving on the road. I actually see, and I'm like, how hard is that? What I'm going to ask is, how hard is it of changing lanes when you have so many blind spots? You are percentage with more blind spots than a normal car. So how difficult is it and how nerve-wracking it is? Because you don't even know if there's a car right sitting right here on your blind spot, and you're switching, and you're afraid you're going to hit somebody. Like, explain how your feelings with that level, and what was your routine on how to make sure when you change lanes you're not going to hit anything?
Well, see, I use the 4-blink rule. I'll let the blinker blink 4 times, but if there's a car halfway, I'll wait for them to go, and then I'll come over. But if there's a car far enough back where I can get over safely without slowing them down, I'll do it. But with that mirror there, I can basically see down the whole side of the truck. So if they're there by the door, I'm pretty good because I can, you know, I can see them. The hardest side is this side.
Right.
So I call it the dog window down here.
Oh, I didn't know you had that.
Yeah, so I can see that there's a car.
See it?
Yeah, so I call it the dog window.
Rollo would love that window.
He would love it, trust me. That's where we go and lick our windows. That's why they call us window lickers. But you can't see from about where the front of the trailer is,
right,
about the sleeper. I can see that far back. So then I depend on that window to see if there's somebody right here. Because I can't see them with that mirror, and I don't have a hood mirror.
So that helps you look at the car level.
Yeah,
what they're passing you, or if you're passing them.
Well, yeah, so like most cars have some kind of form of chrome on the front, so it'll reflect off the fender or something like that.
Oh, okay.
Let me know that.
All right.
So, I mean, you got, like, before the days of trucking, back in the days of trucking, before deregulation and all that, truckers never had CDs.
Yeah.
They had sign language. And most truck drivers, no, actually, if there was a cop on the shoulder or something, they would use sign language to let the other traffic know. So before interstate systems, it was two lanes and 55 miles an hour. And that was trucking back then. Now, I mean, we got interstate systems and all sorts of expressways and tollways. So, I mean, you know, trucking's really took a big change. But the CB thing actually helps because I don't know how to sign language except for one word, you know, and that's, you know, get the fuck out of the way.
Right.
You know.
You know, when it comes to trucking, like, trucks are the only thing that's not really the only thing that attracts me, where it's the trucking, the CB radios, you know, talking to other drivers. And the one thing that amazes me, I only saw it one time in my life, and I was 10 years old, and it was back in the early 90s, where you had a thing that was called a convoy, where you had truck after truck after truck after truck. I only saw it one time, and it was in California.
Wow.
And when I saw that, right after we passed the last truck for the convoy, the leader, all of a sudden we just saw Smokies pulling them over.
Well, see, you know, the thing is, the original convoy where they went from coast to coast, that was the best one of all. I mean, that was in the mid-70s, and, you know, and the thing was back then truckers took, you know, they actually stood side by side with each other. Today, forget about it. I mean, it's a monopoly out here.
Right.
I mean, because no one cares about the other person. Yeah, as long as I'm making mine, I really don't care what y'all are barking about. But sometimes it's good to make a stand. Like, if truckers today took a stand today, in 2 days we could cripple this country. Just that quick. And the only thing we got to do is stop the fuel trucks.
Right.
If we stop the fuel trucks, we stop the cars, we stop the electric, we stop the everything. Because everything's ran by some kind of fuel.
I know I said that was the last question, but I do have one more. If your truck breaks down or your tire pops, where you actually need to call your service, how much of a pain in the butt is that? Have you ever been in that situation where you had no choice to sit and wait for a service truck to come and help you out fixing with the engine or your transmission or a tire or something?
It is a nightmare. It is a nightmare. And
especially in the dark.
Well, it depends on where you break down. If you break out there in the Mojave Desert, just call a tow truck because there's no one out there.
Right.
So you're really going to pay out through the nose. But, I mean, popping a tire, I've sat on the side of the road for 5 hours waiting for someone just to change it. And the reason why it was because it blew so bad if I drove, the rim or the tire would have come off the rim. So it would have caused more of a damage. So I was like, you know, I'm going to make them bring someone out. And that's what they did. But the thing is, I mean, it's so expensive. I mean, for one tire, you could buy, if you drove your truck to the shop, you spend about $300-$400 on the side of the road. It's about $700 now, just for one time.
So when there's damage done to the vehicle, does that come out of your pocket or the company's pocket?
Well, it all depends if it was your fault. If you didn't check your air pressure,
if the tire popped, where does that come out of your pocket or the company?
It all depends, though. I mean, if you didn't pre-trip your truck and check it and make sure the tire was properly inflated, underinflation gets hotter than a tire that's properly inflated. So, I mean, with that being said, you know, it's one of those things. It could fall on the driver, and it could also just be a company.
So how can you tell if it was your fault or if it was, you know, something sharp on the road and it just popped the tire?
Well, I mean,
how can you tell whose fault it was? The glass or you?
It all depends on how it blows. I mean,
but how can you do that if the tire is shredded?
Well, most tires really don't shred. If you think about it, you see the big old caps laying out in the middle of the road. So recaps, they're like a bomb. They'll just, when they go, it's ugly. But it always leaves a big chunk of rubber. So if you go back to that rubber and you look at it a little, you can basically tell the story of what really happened. A tire really doesn't blow unless it has one of the accoutrements to make it blow, a low tire. So the lower, less air pressure it has, the hotter it's going to get.
Right.
So if it's 120 out already and you're running half air pressure, the tire's going to get up to over 200 degrees, it's going to go.
Right. But I do appreciate it and everything. Is there any advice, like, for anybody out there that, you know, is thinking about trucking or anything? Is there any advice that you want to give to these folks? Anything you want to tell them to think about before making that decision? Any advice at all?
Drinking his beer, hold on.
I don't know what it is. I think I got that virus.
Drunk,
No, not yet. Okay. And where's the Jameson? Pass me the Jameson. The best advice is do your research, do your homework. If you're thinking about going with a company, don't tell them how you're going to, oh, you're going to change the world, because they're looking for people that are desperate. Don't play desperate. Act like you got your ducks in a row. Be conservative. Be a poker player. That's the best way to go about it, because less is better, because then they're not expecting much. If you go more, then they're going to give you more, you know? So it's just, it's a back and forth. It's a poker face game. That's what we got.
All right. And like I said, thank you so much, buddy, for visiting us and everything else, and, you know, coming out here and actually giving some time out of your schedule to, have an interview with you. I really do appreciate it, bud.
Dude, if I have the other truck out, we'll do another one.
But, yeah, next time, if you ever get a hold of that 389, you let me know, and we'll make a trip back here.
Dude, if I can get him to, my boss is talking about buying a 359, so if I don't get the 389, I'll bring the 359.
Either way, I like those trucks, so
they're nice.
Well, guys, that is it. If you guys stay tuned, Shelby is going to do a short, tiny little video of camcording live of circling around the truck, on giving you guys how it sounds like from the outside and everything else. So stay tuned for that. But other than that, everybody say bye to Philip Miller.
Later on, guys.
And just thank you for watching King Skeleton Channel. This is Bo.
This is Shelby.
And we are signing out.